After seven games of the World Chess Championship, Magnus Carlsen was leading. Now, yesterday, the players had played this really long game, 6.5 hours, and many felt that today, Anand, 44 years old, would be suffering. But in fact, at the start of the game, it was Carlsen that looked completely wrecked. He was, you know, almost looked like he was sort of falling asleep at the board. Anyway, let's see how this game went. Anand with the white pieces, and it was a queen's gambit declined. Exactly the same as the variation of game three. Bishop f4, quite a trendy line at the moment. But instead of playing knight d7 here, Carlsen went for c5, which is another of the main moves, but it's just not quite in fashion at the moment. This was played a lot in the late 70s, and 1980s and 1990s as well. Kasparov, for example, played this as white. And Anand selects one of the sharpest lines, playing queen c2. And now the main move here is queen a5 and then castles. Well, presumably this would suit Anand, who must have prepared something new in these very complicated positions where you have kings castled on opposite wings. Very theoretical line. But Carlsen very quickly played rook e8. Now, this is an unusual move. It has been seen before, but certainly not one of the main lines. Now, the idea is sometimes to be able to push with e5 and perhaps get in d4 as well. Now, the critical moves here are rook d1 or castles queenside, putting immediate pressure on the pawn on d5. But presumably Anand feared some kind of prepared variation, you know, something very sharp, and he played bishop g5. So that preempts black playing e5 and hitting the bishop. But after bishop e7, somehow, you know, this takes the sting out of this pin, and it's not that sharp. Anand played rook d1 here, and Carlsen dived out of this pin on the d-file and set up his own pin on this diagonal down towards white's king. Anand developed, good move, threatening bishop takes f6 and then bishop takes h7. So h6 from black looks very normal, and the bishop retreated. And here I was expecting bishop d7. Now, it's quite a modest move, but after this, although black is a little bit passive, well, the bishop can withdraw to e8, and I think black is okay there. But instead of this, Carlsen selected a more ambitious continuation. He took on c4 and then played a6, and the idea of this is exactly what happened, is to place the bishop on a more active diagonal. Obviously on the long diagonal it achieves a lot more. But this is risky because it's pushed white's bishop to a dangerous diagonal. Bishop b1 was played. Now the idea is to sometimes take on f6 and then give a big check on the h7 square. Now the obvious move here, g6, rather leaves black's kingside just a little bit sensitive. You can see these pawns, yeah, they're, you know, if they got hit by a sacrifice, I mean, h6 is on prise here, and crucially, black's queen is a very long way from the action. You know, it could be something like this, which brings white's queen closer to the kingside. Now, that is dangerous. So what did Carlsen do? Well, very quickly he played rook d8. Now this is a remarkable move actually, because what he's doing is allowing white's queen to go into h7. But Carlsen has calculated that actually his king is quite safe on e7. Now it is in this position. And this was the game continuation. But Anand didn't check on h7. Instead he played knight e4, hitting the bishop. So that is a nasty threat, because then after taking, the queen will be able to take on h6. But here, after very little reflection, Carlsen withdrew the bishop to e7. Now, if that knight weren't on e7, then queen h7 check, followed by queen h8, would be checkmate. But it seems there's no really decent discovered move with that knight. It's incredible. Knight g3 looks quite dangerous, with the threat of queen h7 and queen h8 mate. So then g6, and if white continues h4, this does look dangerous to break open the position, and black can't block because of knight h5, and that can't be taken again because of the checkmate on h7. But in this position, it looks like Carlsen has a very nice move, queen a4. And in the end game, black will get decent counterplay with his two bishops. And otherwise, if the queen shuffles to the side, then, you know, maybe that queen can come across here. Well, actually, in that position, bishop h4 will just take the pawn. So queen a4, sneaky move, just getting that offside queen back into play. After some thought here, Anand decided to compromise. But perhaps there's nothing better than this. He played knight c5. Now that threatens mate with queen h7 and queen h8, but after this knight is exchanged, incidentally creating an escape square for the king if the check happens. Well, after this, in fact, the danger has passed for Carlsen, and, well, he could trade all the rooks here, but instead he decided to get the queens off the board as quickly as possible. It's a very safe move. And after this, the players started exchanging pieces. So then the queens came off, and then knight e7 frees the bishop and also prepares to challenge rooks on the c-file. And the players exchanged all the rooks on c8. And, well, you could say that white has a symbolic advantage here. This is perhaps a slightly weak pawn. It would be better if the pawn was were on a7. But really, as I said, it's only a symbolic advantage. And over the next few moves, the players moved their kings into the middle, and a draw was soon agreed. So, I think Carlsen can be pretty satisfied with that result. He's getting a little closer to the finishing tape. He said after the game, "I was not in the best of shape," and it really did look shattered, actually. He said, "I was not in the best of shape at the start, but I felt fresher as the game went on." Yeah, a good result for him. And nice preparation. And, well, a little disappointing from Anand that he didn't play something a bit sharper. But a draw is not a disaster for him. He's still only one game down, and he still has four games in which to try to hit back. It's still very close.